Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Creating a Business Plan for Dummies by Veechi Curtis, narrated by Cat Gould. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. I grew up in Scotland, where the winters can be wild, wet, and cold. My father was a self-employed landscape gardener, and each year, as the days grew shorter, he would start hatching entrepreneurial plots to see the family through the scant earnings of the winter months. Handmade garden furniture, barrels from the local brewery scrubbed back and filled with violets, gold leaf mirror restoration, and beach-scavenged scallop shells were but a few of the ill-fated ventures that would transform our Victorian flat into a hive of industry for a few fleeting months of each year. I started my first business at the age of 26 and have been in business ever since, oscillating in a manner not unlike my father's between the more stable income of business consulting and the somewhat precarious existence of writing and publishing. Yet when I was working on this book, I realised something quite fundamental. While I've been steadily successful for more than 20 years, all too often the sensible, cardigan-wearing accountant side of me wins out against the risk-taking, creative, why-don't-we-try-this side of me. Possibly due to the rather feast and famine finances of my childhood, I typically spend more time analysing profit margins than I do thinking of creative new products. I focus more on managing risk than being a trendsetter. If you've been in business before, I'm sure you too have experienced this natural tension between your entrepreneurial side and the inner voice of reason. One challenge for me in writing this book has been to find ways to encourage dreams to flourish while simultaneously exploring the somewhat sobering process of writing a business plan. I'm writing this introduction having just finished the last chapter of this book and, happily, I think that the process has worked on me. I'm itching with impatience to begin my next business venture and feel utterly optimistic about its prospects. I remain my father's daughter, after all. I hope you have a similar experience with this book and that I share enough inspiration for your inner entrepreneur to thrive while at the same time providing unshakable, feet-on-the-ground practicality. About this book. I like to think that this book is a bit different from other business planning books, not least because this book is part of the For Dummies series. Dummies books aren't about thinking that you're a dummy, far from it. What the For Dummies series is all about is balancing heavyweight topics with a lightweight mindset and sharing a can-do attitude that encourages anyone, no matter how young or old, how inexperienced or how veteran, to give the subject at hand a go. I like to think that the dummy's way of thinking has helped me to bring a fresh approach to the subject of business planning. I've tried not to get bogged down in the same old stodgy discussions of mission statements, values, and organisational charts. Instead, I've focused more on working with others, being creative and thinking of your business as something that's unique and separate from yourself. You may be surprised by the fact that I devote 6 whole chapters to the topic of finance. You'll only find 1 finance chapter in most business planning books. I'm a real advocate of the importance of financial planning and, in this book, I try to break the topic down into bite-sized chunks that anyone can understand, even if they haven't done any bookkeeping or accounting before. I also understand that most people who've worked in business end up with knowledge that's patchy. You may know heaps about marketing, but nothing about finance, or vice versa. The beauty of dummies books is that you can just leap in, find the chunk of information that addresses your query, and start listening from there. One more thing. Throughout this book, you'll see sidebars, text that sits in a separate box with grey shading. Think of sidebars as the nut topping on your ice cream. Nice to have, but not essential. Feel free to skip these bits. Foolish assumptions. When writing this book, I make no assumptions about your prior experience. Maybe you've been in business all your life, or maybe you've never been in business before. It could be that you're a tech geek, or it's possible that you hate computers. Maybe you love numbers, or, much more likely, you may have a somewhat queasy feeling when it comes to maths. I also make no assumptions about the age of your business and realise that for many people listening to this book, your business is still a seedling waiting to be watered. For this reason, I include practical advice such as how to budget for personal expenses while you're building your business and why things such as your relationships and family situation are all part of the picture. Last, I don't try to guess where you live in the world. After all, the principles of business planning are universal. Whether you're in the snowdrifts of Alaska, the stone country of Australia, or the quilt-swaying highlands of Scotland. Icons used in this book. Ahead of the pack. Want to get the killer edge? Then look for this handy icon. Check it out. This icon highlights free resources, worksheets, templates and checklists you can find online at dummies.com/go/creating-business-plan. International. This icon alerts you to international differences. I'm not talking about language, colour or creed here, but more mundane matters such as tax rules or government contacts. Remember, tie a knot in that elephant's trunk, pin an egg timer to your shirt, but whatever you do, don't forget the pointers next to this icon. Tip. This icon points to ways to give your business plan that extra spark. True story. Real life stories from others who've been there and done that. Warning. A pitfall for the unwary. Listen to these warnings carefully. Beyond the book. I've created a whole heap of Excel and Word templates to make it easier for you to create your first plan. The Excel templates provide a great starting point for most of the financial projections, while the Word templates help you structure the narrative parts of your plan. You can find all of these templates at dummies.com/go/creating-business-plan. On this webpage, you can also find links to a few extra articles. In one article, I write about the psychology of sales projections, and in another, I talk about managing expenses when cash gets tight. A third article talks about the psychology of goals and the art of setting goals that motivate you and others to carry out your plan. At dummies.com/extras/creating-business-plan, you can also find a bonus part of 10s list, with 10 tips for checking that your business plan idea is strong enough to fly. I also provide a neat video at dummies.com/go/creating-business-plan that corresponds to the Excel tips in Chapter 16, where you can not only watch a demonstration of each one of these tips, but also have the joy of listening to my reassuring voice as the soundtrack. Almost as good, probably even better, than having me in the room beside you. Speaking of which, I really like to think of my books as a conversation with listeners, rather than a one-way monologue. If you have any comments, questions, or feedback, I'd love to hear from you. Please feel free to email me at veechi@veechicurtis.com.au or go to Facebook and search for Veechi Curtis. Where to go from here? Creating a business plan for dummies is not an exciting thriller, probably a good thing given the subject matter, and doesn't require you to start at the beginning and follow through to the end. Instead, feel free to jump in and start listening from whatever section is most relevant to you. New to business and you've never created a business plan before? I suggest you listen to chapters 1, 2, and 3 before doing much else. Chapter 1 provides a roadmap for creating your plan, and chapters 2 and 3 help you to consolidate your business concept. From here, you're probably best to listen to the chapters in the order that I present them, because these chapters follow the same sequence as the topics within a business plan. If business strategy is more your concern, chapters 2, 3, 11, 13, and 14 are the place to be. Are financial projections a source of woe? Chapters 4 to 10 are here to help. For advice on creating a plan that can't fail to impress prospective lenders or investors, chapters 14 and 15 explain how to pull your plan together. Chapter 17 provides tips on getting your plan to look good, and chapter 18 offers a handy checklist to make sure you don't forget a thing. Part 1. Getting started. Getting started with creating a business plan. In this part, explore the whole idea of business planning. Discover how you can prepare your plan in small chunks of time over a period of weeks or even months, and assess the potential of your business idea using a simple scorecard. Figure out what your business does best and identify where the strategic advantage of your business really lies. Explore the delicate relationship between risk and gain, and understand why the craziest ideas often have the most potential. Go underground to research your competitors, creating a full dossier on each one, and position your business against competitors to develop a winning competitive strategy. Never gaze awkwardly at your feet again. Prepare the killer elevator speech instead. Chapter 1. Letting your plan take flight. In this chapter, getting started without another moment's hesitation, thinking about the structure of your plan and how long it's going to take. Eating, drinking, sleeping, and planning, all part of everyday life. Summarising everything on a single page. Rating yourself and your business idea with a quick and easy quiz. You probably already know that if you spend time working on your business rather than just working in your business, you have a heaps better chance of higher sales, more profit, and a generally easier existence. One of the main reasons people don't get around to creating a business plan is that they think they don't have enough time. Pish tosh, you don't need to spend weeks creating an impressive 30-page document. Instead, what you need to do is change your way of thinking. Rather than making a daily to-do list of all the people you have to call, brew yourself a cup of tea and have a think about your pricing strategies. Rather than fretting about all the jobs that need doing, spend a couple of hours researching your competitors. Some of the most important elements of a business plan can be done while you're in the shower, on the beach, or driving in the car. Attitude is everything. To create a great business plan, all you need is a willingness to be objective about your strategy, the discipline to analyse your financials, even if you're not naturally good with numbers, and the ability to think of your business as something that's separate from you. So, no more excuses, no skipping to another chapter, no closing this book with a sigh. It's time to start planning. And there's no time like the present. Getting your feet wet and having fun. In creating a business plan for dummies, I place less emphasis on the importance of creating a written plan and more on why planning is best viewed as an all-year-round activity. The neat thing about this way of thinking is that you can start with your plan at any time, even if you know you only have 1 hour free this week and you're flying to Europe for a skiing holiday the next. Planning can be a heap of fun once you get started. Some of my best business ideas have come to me while lying in the hammock at our holiday house, digging up weeds in the garden, or having a quiet coffee down at the village. Deciding who this plan is for. You, of course. Your plan is an ongoing process, not a massive document that you create every year or so. Feel free to pick a structure, time, and format that works well for you. Occasionally, other people may want to have a sticky beak at your plan, usually prospective investors or lenders. On these occasions, you probably want to create a formal plan using a fairly traditional format and focus more on the presentation and readability of your plan. One thing to bear in mind, however, regardless of who is likely to read your plan, I strongly suggest that when it comes to the financials, sales targets, income projections, profit projections, and so on, you be consistent. Don't have one version of financials for your own purpose and another spruced up version for the bank. True story. One of my first jobs after I graduated was as a warehouse manager for a small but growing company. Money was always tight and we were forever presenting new plans and cash flow projections to prospective lenders. Part of my job was to massage the figures to show that while cash was desperate in the coming 6 months or so, and hence loan funds were required, things would soon turn the corner and, within a couple of years, we would be awash with funds. I discovered how easy it was to manipulate figures, a topic I explore further in Chapter 8 when I look at scenario analysis. By adding 10% to sales, trimming expenses by the same amount, and maybe increasing the gross profit a little, I could transform dire predictions into something that looked amazing. Trouble is, these figures were pure fiction. The manipulated scenarios inevitably created a false sense of security and led to some pretty poor long-term decision-making. The moral of the tale? Don't get hoodwinked into selling your plan and exaggerating your likely success. Stay as realistic as possible. This tactic will help you gain respect from any likely investors and keep you grounded as to what lies ahead. Choosing your dance partners. As a business owner, you need to have a good understanding of your financials, a solid commitment to marketing, a razor-sharp insight into your competition, and a keen sense of strategy. Even if you don't have all of these skills yet, I can't think of a better way of acquiring these skills than getting involved in your business plan. Experience is a generous teacher. Having said this, unless you've run a business before, you'll almost certainly need a little help from outside. Good news is that all you have to do is ask. Consider the following sources. Tip: business planning courses. In my opinion, a structured course spread over several weeks or even months is the best possible way to accumulate basic planning skills. Not only do you have the discipline of working on your plan at least once a week, but you also usually receive expert mentoring from the teacher or teachers, as well as peer support from other people in a similar position to you. Business advisory centres. Depending on where you are in the world, business advisory centres have different names and structures. However, most state and federal governments fund some form of free advisory centres. Business consultants. While I warn against delegating the whole planning process to outsiders, expert consultants can be a great resource, especially if you retain control and ownership of your plan. Your accountant. I strongly recommend that you do your own financial projections rather than delegating this task to a bookkeeper or accountant. I explain just how in chapters 4 through to 10. However, after you have made your best attempt, consider asking your accountant to review your figures and help you to identify anything that doesn't make sense or seems unrealistic. Your lawyer. In Chapter 14, I talk about managing risk, including protecting your name and your brand, and limiting liability through company structures. Your lawyer is an excellent source of advice for this part of the planning process. Friends and family. Not only is the advice of friends and family usually free, but these people also understand you like nobody else. Support and encouragement from friends and family is invaluable on those doubtful days when you think you and your new business idea may be crazy. Your spouse or life partner. Last but not least, need I say more? Looking at different online planning tools. In creating a business plan for dummies, I try to provide you with everything you need to build your plan, including a whole bunch of free templates and resources that you can download from dummies.com/go/creating-business-plan. You may be wondering how these templates compare to the many business planning templates or software applications you can find online, many of which are also free. At a surface level, most of these templates provide you with pretty much everything you need to create a plan. However, when writing this book, I've reflected on my experience from running business plan courses. What I find is that some concepts of business planning that may take only a few sentences to summarise are really hard for those new to business to grasp. For example, almost anyone can explain the concept of strategic advantage in a few sentences, and most business planning templates simply provide a word template with a few blank lines in which you can write your strategic advantage. In real life, I find that these concepts usually take several sessions to gel with my students. It's for this reason that I devote two whole chapters to the concepts of strategic and competitive advantage, chapters 2 and 3, and I recommend you listen to these chapters early in your business planning process so you can be sure a solid foundation is in place when you create your plan. However, what you may find works well is to use a business planning template in conjunction with this book. You can find a whole heap of industry-specific templates online, and you may even find topics within these templates that I don't cover in detail within this book. Bplans at bplans.com is probably the world's leader in business planning templates and software, and provides an excellent starting point. Ahead of the pack. As well as business planning templates, you can also consider business planning software. You can either buy software that you install on your computer, such as Business Plans Pro, available from bplans.com, or MAUS Masterplan, available from maus.com.au. Or you can subscribe to online planning software in the cloud, such as liveplan.com or planhq.com. I prefer cloud-based software because you can pay as you go, and because the cloud makes working collaboratively with others so much easier. The main difference between business planning templates and business planning software is the sophistication of the financials. For example, the financials in most business planning software packages, including those in the cloud, include profit and loss projections, cash flow projections, budgets, break-even analysis, balance sheets, and more. You usually find that all the financials interconnect so that if you change a figure in your profit and loss projection, the change automatically flows through to the other financial reports. Tip: while business planning software can be a real benefit if figures and maths don't come naturally to you, the downside can be inflexibility. For example, you may find that you can't adapt the list of expenses or that the format for sales projections is limited. Assuming you have a decent internet connection, why not weigh up the pros and cons for yourself by subscribing to a service such as liveplan.com for 30 days or so. Subscriptions cost approximately $19.95 US per month, and a small payment of this nature is hardly likely to break the bank. Are you ready? I find that if someone really wants to start their own business, wild horses can't hold them back. The idea keeps coming around and around until that person finally takes the leap and says, I'm going to give it a go. So if you're champing at the bit to start your new business, I have just three questions to ask you first. Do you have experience in the kind of business you're planning to start? For example, if you're looking at buying a coffee van, have you actually spent a few days selling coffee in this way? Do you have barista or retail experience? Do you definitely have enough capital to get started? If you're not sure, do you think you may be better saving for a while before you launch your business? See Chapter 4 for more on budgeting for startup expenses. Is your partner or spouse supportive? I remember my now ex-husband wanting to start up in business when our first child was just 6 months old. He was ready to start a new business, but I certainly wasn't. If your answer to any of these questions is no, I suggest that you try to temper your enthusiasm just a little. And if you still can't wait, then, hey, I completely understand. Scoping the nature of your plan. While planning is certainly best done on an ongoing basis, the ideal approach the very first time you create a business plan is to cover all the elements of your plan: concept, strategy, financials, marketing, people, and so on, within a reasonable time frame, and then collate all your workings into a single document. This approach requires a certain level of discipline, but by the time you get to the end, you're going to be left with a major sense of achievement. Structuring your plan. The best format for a business with a turnover of $100 million and 200 employees is going to be utterly different from the best format for a startup business with no employees. For this reason, you can find as many possible formats for a business plan as recipes for bolognese sauce. What most formats have in common, however, is certain key elements, although the sequence of these elements varies. See the following section for how much planning time each of the elements is likely to require. I tell you where to find more detailed information on each one in the following section as well. Here are the key elements of a business plan. An overview of the business and its strategy. This introduction to your plan includes your mission, a brief description of your business, and a strategic advantage statement. A complete summary of financials. At its simplest, the financial part of your plan may only include a profit and loss projection for the next 12 months. More detailed plans include profit and loss projections for 24 or 36 months ahead, plus historical profit and loss reports and balance sheets for the previous year or years. Financials often also include break-even analysis, cash flow projections, and budgets. A people plan. Who are you and why are you so awesome? What are your skills and the skills of those involved in your business? A marketing plan. A marketing plan is usually several pages long and includes competitor analysis, unique selling points, target market analysis, sales targets, marketing strategies, and a bit more besides. An analysis of industry and economic trends, as well as a summary of what you perceive to be opportunities or threats. No business is an island, particularly in a very fast-changing world. This part of your plan looks at factors outside of your control, such as industry or economic trends, possible opportunities that your business could exploit, and threats that you need to guard against. Your risk management plan also belongs in this section. Note, you may find that the industry analysis section sits better in the first part of your plan, immediately following your business and strategic overview, so that you provide a complete summary of your strategic platform. A summary of your goals. Here's where you get to share your dreams, neatly sliced and diced into monthly, six-monthly, and yearly goals. In this book, I work through the preceding six key elements in sequence The only exception is the mission statement, which normally goes at the beginning of a business plan, which I don't address until chapter 15. From experience, I find it works best to delay writing a mission statement until further into the planning process. Setting aside enough time. Here's a bit more detail about how much time the different elements of a business plan, refer to the preceding section, typically require and how often you need to attend to them. Business model and strategy. How long does it take to come up with a decent business model? If you're lucky, you may be able to come up with a winning strategy over the course of a few drinks in the back of a pub. Alternatively, you may find that it takes years to come up with a strong strategy that really works. Remember, as well as coming up with a strong business strategy, the other element of developing your business model is doing a detailed analysis of your competitors. This process usually takes only a few hours, but is something that you should do every 6 months or so that you avoid being caught by surprise. I talk about business strategy in chapters 2, 11, and 13, and focus on competitive analysis in chapter 3. Financials. Creating a profit and loss projection, chapters 5 through to 8, can be pretty time-consuming the first time around, and may take several days if you're not used to working with figures or Excel. Stick with the process, though, and the next time around will only take a fraction of the time. Similarly, a cash flow projection, chapter 10, can be quite technically demanding and may take many hours to pull together, especially the first time. So how often do you need to repeat the process? I recommend you compare budgets against actual results every month when you look at your profit and loss report. As patterns emerge, maybe you can see that you consistently over or underestimate something. Return to your overall profit and loss projections, revise your figures, and extend these projections once more so they span a full 12 months ahead. Ahead of the pack. If your business is always tight for cash and you carry high levels of stock or customer debt, you or your finance manager may need to do cash flow projections all year round, updating figures on a constant basis. I explain how to create a profit and loss projection in chapters 5 to 8 and talk about cash flow projections in chapter 10. Later in this chapter, see Going for Rhythm with Financial Planning, I also talk about the financial planning cycle and about how one activity naturally flows into another. People plan. A business isn't anything without the people who run it, and your skills, entrepreneurialism, and natural abilities are as much a part of the mix as anything else, as are the skills of the people you choose to involve in your business. This part of your plan needs to outline the people element of your business. Who does what and why they're the best choice for the job. Even if you don't have any employees yet, you can still include details about any consultants, advisors, mentors, or professionals who you plan to involve in your business. These details help to establish credibility for anybody else reading your plan and prompt you to think further outside the business than just yourself. Chapter 2 touches on this topic, while Chapter 11 explores the people side of your plan in more depth. People planning doesn't necessarily take a huge amount of time at first, but is something that can be a huge time waster if you don't get it right. Marketing plan. I love doing marketing plans. Thinking about sales strategies is such a creative process that it's hard not to feel a charge of energy and inspiration as you flesh out your ideas. The first time you create a marketing plan can take anything from several hours to several days. After the first time, however, maintaining a coherent marketing plan generally only requires a half day or so every 6 months. I talk about the marketing cycle later in this chapter. See Keeping Everything on Track with Your Marketing Cycle and explore marketing plans in detail in Chapter 12. Looking into the future. In this book, I emphasize reporting for financial projections rather than reporting on actual financial results. I do this for two reasons. First, many people listening to this book are going to be working on their first business plan and won't have any results for previous months or years as yet. Second, even if you've been trading for some time, you will always reap benefits from making financial projections and experimenting with different scenarios, such as what could happen if you increased sales by 10% or decreased expenses by a similar amount. However, if you've been trading for a while, you do need to include historical figures, profit and loss and balance sheet, for the last year or 2 years in your business plan. These actual results provide a great reality check for you, or anybody else, when comparing future projections against past performance. Situational analysis. The first time you do this part of your plan, which includes both an industry analysis as well as a SWOT, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats analysis, can take a fair chunk of time, depending on the depth in which you choose to explore this topic. I don't usually see the need for you to update the written element of this part of your plan any more often than once a year. However, being alert to the impact of things changing around you is something you want to maintain all year round. Find ways to stay tuned to changes in your industry, possibly by attending conferences, subscribing to forum boards, researching information on industry websites, or attending industry association meetings. Planning for risk doesn't generally require significant time on an ongoing basis, but tends to demand your attention in fits and starts. For example, trademarking a logo or drawing up employee contracts may take several days to organise. However, I suggest you allow at least half a day or so each year to review your risk management strategies. I talk about situational and risk analysis in chapters 13 and 14. An action plan. The action plan is where you weave all the other elements of your plan together into a neat summary of goals and objectives, each one with a time frame. In other words, the action plan is the section that endeavours to keep you on track, hopefully providing a calendar of activities for the months to come. An action plan usually only takes an hour or two to pull together at the end of the planning process, but once done, is something that you should try to keep constantly updated. I talk about creating your action plan in Chapter 15. Deciding how far into the future you want to go. In this book, I focus on projections that cover the next 12 months, or the first 12 months from when a business starts trading. I do this largely for simplicity's sake. The principle of creating a financial projection for 24 months is exactly the same principle as for 12 months. All you're doing is adding a few more columns. In practice, how far you should extend your plan into the future really depends on the nature of your business and how long it has been established. Here's what I suggest. Tip: for most new businesses, a 12-month financial projection works just fine, although most traditional business planning books talk about building financial projections for the next 2, 3, or even 5 years ahead. I find that for new businesses, this long-term approach quickly spills into fiction territory. If you have no idea what sales you're going to make this month or next, how can you realistically predict what sales you'll make in 3 years' time? For new or growing businesses, where the projections show low profitability in the first 12 months because the business requires a certain sales volume before it really starts to work, I suggest you extend your projections for at least a couple of years. This is the only way you can assess the long-term viability of your concept. For an established business with 3 or more years of trading history, I recommend you extend your financial projections 24 months ahead. Understanding why your plan needs constant love and attention. In the preceding section, can you see that some elements of a business plan require much more regular attention than others? This is just one reason why creating a business plan once every year or two and then leaving it on a shelf to gather dust is a strategy for failure. Once you finish your first business plan, I strongly suggest that you continue to update different elements as time allows and circumstances demand. The two elements within a business plan that require the most ongoing attention are your financial plan and your marketing plan. Each of these activities has its own planning cycle. Going for rhythm with financial planning. Figure 1-1 shows a typical financial planning cycle with the review of your business model at the beginning and end of each process. Here's how you can work through the financial planning cycle. 1. Review business model and strategy. I talk about business models and strategy in chapters 2, 3, and 11. In the context of your financial planning cycle, the idea is that if you can't get your financials to look healthy, you probably need to review the way you're doing, or planning to do, business. 2. Review your prices, rates, and sales projections. Setting prices and sales targets, a topic I cover in Chapter 5, is both a financial and a marketing activity, and sales projections usually form part of your marketing plan. Some business planning books suggest you do your marketing plan before your financial projections, but I prefer to work on pricing and sales projections first. Tip: my argument for working on your pricing and sales projections before your marketing plan is this. If you haven't set your prices, you can't do any meaningful financial forecasts. Without financial forecasts, you don't know if your business model has any chance at all. And without having your essential idea confirmed, what is the point of doing a marketing plan? All very chicken and egg in its nature, but essentially you have to start somewhere. 3. Confirm the direct costs of providing your service or making your products. I talk about costing products and services in Chapter 6 and explain how to create a gross profit projection for the next 12 months. 4. Create a forecast for expenses. If you're just getting started, I suggest you create a budget both for business and personal expenses. See Chapter 7. For simple cash-based businesses, this expense forecast becomes your budget for the months ahead. 5. Create a profit and loss projection for the next 12 months. In Chapter 8, I explain how to create a profit and loss projection and how to forecast your net profit over the next 12 months. 6. Work out your break-even point. You can calculate your break-even point in several different ways. Chapter 9 explains just how. Understanding this information is a powerful weapon in your business artillery. 7. Generate a cash flow projection. Even if you're making a profit, you may find yourself short of cash. In Chapter 10, I explain how to generate a cash flow projection so that you can anticipate any cash shortfalls. Remember. 8. Set sales targets and expense budgets for the 12 months ahead. Committing to budgets is one of the most important elements of the financial planning cycle. In Chapter 10, I explain the subtle difference between projections and budgets. 9. Continually review actual results against budgets and tweak your pricing, strategy, and budgets accordingly. With finances, you can't set and forget. Instead, the trick is to monitor your actual performance and compare this against your budgets every single month. For example, if sales fall short of targets, you need to sell more, change pricing, or pull back on expenses. If sales go over targets, you probably want to look at your cash flow projection and check that you can finance this growth. Remember, Can you see how it really doesn't work to create a 12-month profit and loss projection as part of your business plan and then think to yourself, cool, that's finished for the year? I've yet to see a business where actual results are exactly the same as budgets. You will always get a difference, and you need to manage these differences on an ongoing basis. Keeping everything on track with your marketing cycle. When you're in business, the process of marketing never stops. By marketing, I don't just mean advertising or sales strategies. Rather, I mean everything from understanding competitors to analysing customers and from reviewing pricing to ensuring excellent customer service. The pace of change in most business environments is so fast that you can't afford to let a whole year go by without reviewing your marketing plan. In just the same way as you need to compare actuals against budgets every month for your income and expenses, refer to preceding section, you also need to review your sales targets every month against actual results. Look at the detail. Even if total sales come close to budget, did the sales come from a different source than you had anticipated? What are the trends? Do you need to revise your marketing plan or change your sales budgets and, therefore, your expense budgets too? Figure 1-2 shows a typical marketing cycle. I explain each step of this cycle in detail in Chapter 12. Can you see how the fifth step of the marketing cycle, review pricing, rates and sales projections, is exactly the same as the second step of the financial cycle shown in Figure 1 in the preceding section of this chapter? That's because setting sales targets is always the point at which the sales team and the bean counters connect. True story. A few years ago, I worked as a consultant to a very sales-orientated business, helping to look at the finances and general profitability. One of the dynamics at play was that the company would have 6 monthly sales meetings at which they'd set sales budgets for the year ahead. The vibe at these meetings was always pretty buoyant, and the sales budgets reflected this. After these meetings, I'd be given these sales budgets and work with the general manager to set expense budgets accordingly. The general manager never wanted to lower sales budgets for fear her sales team would become complacent, but when working with this over-optimistic set of figures, she inevitably set her expense budgets too high. Eventually, I persuaded the general manager to have 2 sets of sales budgets on the go at any one time. The first set was what the sales team came up with, and these budgets became their targets. The second set, which we didn't share with anyone in sales, was what we thought sales were likely to be, based on the previous year's results, plus a modest 2% for growth. We then set the expense budgets accordingly. This method worked really well for the company, balancing the psychology of different individuals perfectly. Conjuring up a one-page business plan. When I was talking to my publishing manager at Wiley about writing this book, we played around with a whole heap of different possible titles. One of the ideas Claire came up with was creating a one-page business plan for dummies. My response was one of immediate enthusiasm. A one-page business plan sounds so quick and easy, I thought everyone would buy a book with that title. But then, like Pinocchio, my conscience kicked in. I knew that a one-page business plan is never enough. You simply can't fit everything you need to know on one page, and to suggest anything otherwise would just be a whopping fib. So we came up with a different and much more realistic title. The one-page business plan idea sticks around, however, and at times does have a role to play. I like to think of the one-page plan as being a summary of the overall plan, a way to provide a bit of daily inspiration and keep everyone on track with overall goals. Figure 1-3 shows an example of a one-page plan generated by MAUS, Master Plan Software, and how this summary concept can work. Remember, one-page plans are best if you create them with a specific audience in mind. I've seen one-page plans that are essentially pitches to lenders of a new idea, or one-page plans that provide performance summaries for senior management. The only time I created a one-page plan, I made a hybrid between planning elements, listing my mission and strategic advantage at the top of the document, and goal setting, listing milestones and dates for the months ahead. If you want to create a one-page plan for your business, I suggest you start by doing a complete plan, culminating in some kind of longer document, as explained in Chapter 15. With this complete, have a think about what kind of summary you would like to see, and whether a monthly, one-page plan is going to work for you. True story. I know a very successful CEO who expects each of his six managers to report on just 8 figures every Friday. For the marketing manager, these figures include the number of hits on the website, new inquiries, the conversion rate, and total marketing expenditure. For the project manager, figures include total hours worked for the current major project, total hours overtime, cost of overtime, and percentage completion rate. Other managers contribute different information again. These results are all compiled onto a single dashboard that the CEO monitors constantly. Scoring your business out of 10. Are you still at the stage of thinking about your business idea and wondering if it's worth you even doing a plan? Maybe your business idea is still a glint in the eye, or maybe you've been mooching along half-heartedly with a new business for a little while now and don't know where you're headed. Just for a bit of fun, this is Chapter 1, after all, why not take a few minutes out and see how you and your business idea rate? Use the scorecard in Table 1-1 if yours is a business that's been done before. By done before, I mean a business selling a service or product that many others already provide, such as a gardening business, general store, dry cleaners, or restaurant. Alternatively, if your business or business idea is a niche business or a new invention, use the scorecard in Table 1-2. For each question, a score of 1 is bad and a score of 10 is good. Wondering what a niche business is? A niche business is one that specializes in a small market segment. I came across a quirky example of a niche business just today. The company is called Dirty Rotten Flowers and creates unique bouquets for those who are wronged in love to send to the one who wronged them. My favourite is probably the I Love You Not bouquet, which includes a dozen twisted red carnations, accompanied by a teddy bear embroidered with these very words. What score are you looking for? Overall, you probably want to get a score of 35 or more, although don't be dismayed if you score less than this. Chapters 2, 3, 11 and 13 provide lots of inspiration for developing your business ideas. Chapters 4 to 10 help you consolidate your financial skills, and Chapter 12 helps with the marketing side of things. You can return to this scorecard later in the planning process and see if your score improves. Remember, tread gently, lest you tread upon your dreams. The very nature of business planning often means taking a slightly conservative approach, dealing with facts and figures rather than dreams and inspirations. But whatever you feel when working through your plan, stay tuned to that germ of inspiration that caused you to get to this point in the first place. Building any new business is a creative process and one that requires you to believe in yourself and your own abilities. This belief and creativity is what separates the natural entrepreneur from the 9-to-5 office worker. This belief is what will ultimately lead you to business success and its many associated rewards. Chapter 2. figuring out what's so special about you and your business. In this chapter, thinking about what edge you have over others, understanding the relationship between risk and potential gain, scoring your strategic advantage from 1 to 10, writing up your strategic advantage statement, rethinking whether your business idea is really strong enough to fly. What is it that makes you or your business so special? Even if you have a business that's similar to thousands of others, maybe you mow lawns, have a hairdressing salon, or tutor high school students, you still need to come up with an idea that makes your business different from others in some way, or that provides you with a competitive edge. Similarly, if your business caters for a very specific niche, maybe you sell gluten-free cookies or baby clothes made from organic cotton, you still need to identify how you can service this niche in a way that others can't. Or what is it about your skills or circumstances that enables you to service this niche better than others? If your business centres on an idea that nobody has tried before, you need to address why nobody else has bothered to try this idea until now and, in the event that you're successful, what prevents others from copying your idea straight away. The essence of what makes your business special, or more likely to succeed than others, is called your competitive or strategic advantage. I believe that this advantage is the single most important ingredient for ongoing business success, which is why, in this chapter, I focus exclusively on this very subject. Understanding strategic advantage. In the introduction for this chapter, I mentioned the terms competitive advantage and strategic advantage. Like many people, I tend to use these terms synonymously, but to be really precise, you could argue they relate to slightly different aspects of your business. A competitive advantage is something that's different, better than, or not offered by your competitors. For example, if a town has two hairdressing salons and one offers a mobile service but the other doesn't, the first salon has a competitive advantage because they're providing something their competitors aren't. A strategic advantage is something that stems from capabilities within your business that are hard for others to copy. These capabilities tend to be a unique blend of assets, knowledge, people networks, skills or technology. For example, imagine the owner of the salon with the mobile haircutting service has a background in nursing and so has a natural understanding of the needs of her many elderly housebound clients. Imagine also that the owner's husband is a mechanic, which means the vehicle used for providing the salon's mobile service is kept on the road at minimal cost. This unique blend of skills and cost efficiency forms part of this salon's strategic advantage. Having said all this, competitive and strategic advantages tend to overlap so much that I try to avoid getting bogged down in arguing about the distinction. I use the term strategic advantage in this chapter because, after all, a true strategic advantage should ultimately result in a competitive advantage. But if you'd rather use the term competitive advantage in your business plan, that's just fine. Looking at examples of strategic advantage. How can your business beat the competition, and what benefits can you provide that the competition can't? Here are some ways that your business may be able to secure a strategic advantage against others in the same industry. Ahead of the pack. Added value. Can you offer added value in comparison to your competitors? Think 24-hour delivery, locally sourced product, a mobile service, or a quality of product or service that's beyond industry norms. Exclusive distribution rights. Do you have exclusive distribution rights to a sought-after product or service? First cab off the rank? Do you have a new idea that nobody else has tried before, or a new way of doing something that makes the product or service better, quicker, or cheaper. Intellectual property. Do you have unique intellectual property, or IP, that customers want and that's hard to copy? IP includes copyright patents and trademarks. If you're just getting started with your business, your IP could be as simple as a clever business name, an eye-catching logo, or a well-chosen domain name, that is, a web address. Location. If you're a retailer, do you have a great location in a central shopping area? Location is always the prime strategic advantage for retailers. Or are you the only business providing a service in a particular suburb or region? Are the demographics of your location ideally matched to your business? Or are you located in a central spot for freight and transport? Lower costs. Do you have an innovative way of doing things that reduces costs, creates economies of scale, or significantly improves business processes? Obsession and drive. Do you have exceptional vision or drive? Is this drive connected with a particular obsession? For example, think of Steve Jobs and his obsession about design. Perfectly matched team. If you're in a business partnership of some kind, do you have a unique combination of skills and do you work well together as a team? The synergy created by two or more people who have complementary skills and who work well together can be a force to be reckoned with and something that's hard for competition to copy. Specialist skills. Are you a specialist who has an insight into a particular industry that nobody else is likely to have? Maybe you can see a gap in the industry that nobody else is catering for, or maybe you can see a way to do something better. Tip. Think of a business that you know that has been really successful, maybe a local business or a friend's business, or even a big name such as The Body Shop, McDonald's, or Microsoft. Go through the list of different strategic advantages and think about which of these advantages could apply to these businesses. Focusing on real-life examples. Try to deepen your understanding of strategic advantage, refer to the preceding section, by applying the concept to a few real-life situations that are easy to imagine. Picture yourself sitting in a room with four people and each of these people sharing their idea for a new business. Lloyd plans to start a business mowing lawns in his local neighbourhood. Tess has recently qualified as an acupuncturist and plans to start up a practice specialising in children's health. Dave has an idea to provide a mobile home safety service, installing devices such as gates, cupboard latches, and electrical safety switches to make homes toddler-proof. His wife is in real estate and has great marketing skills. Layla, who is a musician, has partnered with a friend with IT skills to develop a smartphone app that simulates turntable scratch rhythms so kids can add their own backing tracks to playlists. Referring to the strategic advantages listed in the preceding section, have a think about which of these advantages could be relevant to the example businesses. You can see how I've rated the strategic advantage potential for each of the four businesses in Table 2-1. Of course, just because I've written yes against a strategic advantage doesn't mean that this advantage necessarily exists. Rather, what I'm saying is that potential exists. For example, I've written yes against specialist skills for the iPhone app. However, not everyone who tries to develop an iPhone app will necessarily have good programming skills. Have a look at Table 2-1 and see if you agree with my assessment of potential advantages. For example, can you think of ways that someone with a lawn mowing business could get an edge over competition with added value services, location, or lower costs? Understanding how risk relates to gain. In most situations, the business with the highest potential strategic advantage is going to be the business that requires the most capital or involves the highest risk of failure. For example, in Table 2-1, the business with the highest number of yeses in the strategic column is the smartphone app. However, look back to the business idea itself, developing a custom-written smartphone app for a very niche market, and you can see that the idea is full of risk. Layla will have high development costs, an unknown and untested market, and a product that may not even work that well when complete. Similarly, the toddler safety business has the advantages of being a new idea and something that clearly adds value for customers, but involves fairly substantial risks. Because this is a new service, people aren't going to look around thinking to hire someone to make their home toddler-proof. Dave will have to spend a lot of money on marketing to make consumers aware of his services, and he may yet find that there isn't enough demand for his business idea. In contrast, lawn mowing has few potential strategic advantages, but involves the lowest risk of all. The cost for Lloyd to set up his business could be as low as a few business cards. Strategic advantages are hard to find for Lloyd's business because a lawn is only ever a lawn, and Lloyd is limited to what he can offer that others can't. However, I've still written maybe against three possible strategic advantages for Lloyd's lawn mowing business. Added value? Maybe Lloyd has some specialist horticultural knowledge that could differentiate him from his competitors. Location? Maybe Lloyd would be providing the only service in his suburb. Or maybe he lives in a very exclusive suburb with lots of high-income earners. Lower costs? Maybe Lloyd's teenage son works for him at low hourly rates, enabling Lloyd to offer very competitive prices. Remember, thinking of potential strategic advantages for a business or service that lots of other people provide and where it's difficult to differentiate between your service and those of your competitors is usually much harder. The upside of this kind of business is that the risks are usually lower. The downside is that it's always going to be tricky to charge premium rates or make above-average profits. Justifying why you can succeed. In the preceding sections in this chapter, I explore the concept of strategic advantage in relation to a range of possible businesses. I like to work with examples in this way because the different business scenarios help to highlight how this concept changes so much depending on the context. In this section, I help you to apply the concept of strategic advantage to your business. I help you go digging to identify what it is that makes you different and suggest you apply a strategic advantage scorecard to your business concept. Remember, if you're struggling to come up with anything that's special about your business, maybe you haven't stumbled on that winning idea quite yet, please do persist. The process of identifying your strategic advantage is even more important for you. Uncovering your inner mojo. One good way to broaden your sense of where your strategic advantage may lie is to look at your existing customers and their buying patterns. Or, if you haven't started your business yet, imagine what these answers might be. Ask yourself these questions. When customers come to me, why is that? When potential customers go to my competitors instead, why is that? When potential customers make an inquiry but end up not purchasing my goods or services, why is that? Are the benefits I offer, or intend to offer, to my customers?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.